When I was first diagnosed with CLL, my doctor told me straight up that I was going to die in about 6 years. And that doctor got fired. My next doctor told me, don't worry, we've got this. You might die with this, but you're not going to die from this. My name's Jeff Folloder. I am a passionate patient advocate. I am now in year 14 of my little journey with CLL, and I am living a great life. And that's why I became a patient advocate, because I want to make sure that everyone knows that it is possible to live a great life with CLL.
I'm Michele Nadeem-Baker. I'm a medical and health journalist, but in addition to that, I am also a CLL patient. And I started advocating for other patients my first day of treatment when I realized that there is just so much unknown there, and to demystify things for my fellow patients and help them through their journey. Jeff?
Let's chat a little bit about the tests that are needed to diagnose CLL and then accurately inform those potential treatments. A lot of us on the support groups and in social media, we love tossing around the cute names, the FISH test, the flow test. Not a lot of people truly understand what's going on with those tests. They don't understand the concept of chromosomal abnormalities that may be going on with a patient at time of diagnosis. Dr. Coombs, can you briefly give us a top line as to what these tests are doing, and more importantly, what they're telling you in terms of prognostics?
Absolutely. So, you know, before the advent of all these, let's call them sophisticated tests, we would stage patients. And so that's always what, you know, I think cancer patients think of is, what stage am I? And so we do have a staging system called the RI staging system that we use in the US. In the Europe, they use this Binet staging system. But the idea is, how much is the CLL like really affecting me? And so RI stage 0 is when it's just a high white count, up to a RI stage 4 when you have low platelets from the CLL. And so I'm taking a step back, because there were, you know, for decades, ways of saying, is this a good CLL or a bad CLL? However, what we've learned over the years is that there are some patients with really early stage disease that would follow very aggressive clinical courses. And then some, you know, that may have been technically a RI stage 4 that are totally stable for decades. And so, you know, the goal with all these more sophisticated tests was to better predict, how is this person's CLL going to behave? Which then helps us as clinicians to know what to expect. And it helps the patient as far as what, you know, he or she should expect. So taking a step back, we now have a lot of advanced testings that we can send. The good news is that these can be sent on the peripheral blood. And so it's not necessary to get a bone marrow biopsy early on. Of course, we do consider these at time of therapy. But we can send these tests in the blood, because the CLL by its nature is circulating in the blood. And so we can pick up different abnormalities that can tell us, is this a good CLL or a bad CLL, or maybe somewhere in the middle, to help us, number one, know, should we follow this person more closely? Number two, is this someone that perhaps it's less likely to cause trouble than not? So the categories of tests are, number one, looking at the DNA, which is either via a FISH test, which uses fluorescent probes to find common abnormalities that are known to be seen in CLL. So the most adverse being the 17p deletion, and then on the other spectrum, the most favorable being an isolated 13q deletion. However, what we've learned is that this is only looking at certain probes. Sometimes you can have other abnormalities that aren't present as part of the FISH panel. So in my own practice, I do also send a karyotype test, which is looking for the same thing, abnormal chromosomes, but instead of using a pre-selected panel of common abnormalities in CLL, it just looks at all the chromosomes. And so the chromosomes, just for, you know, the patient's knowledge, are just the big chunks of DNA that live inside every one of our cells, but we're obviously focusing on what these abnormalities are in the CLL cells, because there are common patterns. And so there are good patterns, bad patterns. And then it's also just bad to have a complex karyotype, meaning more than three or more abnormalities in any given cell. So that's one category. the 17p deletion I mentioned is known to kind of behave more aggressively. It's still a chronic disease, CLL, but those are often the bad actors, especially back in the chemo days when chemo just like doesn't work well at all. It does do better with our new drugs, but that is a particular problem because it deletes a copy of this very important gene called TP53. And so we used to think the only way of losing that gene is by just completely deleting the part of the chromosome where it's contained. What has been learned, I'd say over the past 10 to 15 years now, maybe in CLL, is that it may not be deleted, but it could be mutated. And so that's another test that I think is very wise to send, especially in patients who are going to need treatment, because a TP53 mutation is largely the same as a 17p deletion. Now, there are a little bit of nuances there, but these are two separate tests, but they do both give similar information because those two abnormalities are treated as one and the same as far as their impact on prognosis. The next category of testing is looking at the immunoglobulin heavy chain status. And so a normal B cell over its life, so CLL is a cancer of B cells, undergoes a process of somatic hypermutation where it just acquires mutations. So it's actually good to have a mutated immunoglobulin heavy chain. The bad finding is for that to be unmutated, which suggests this is a bit more primitive of a cell. And what's been borne out through, you know, a lot of studies is that patients with unmutated are the ones who need therapy quicker and, you know, they don't respond as well to certain therapies. Now, again, the negative predictive impact of some of these abnormalities is somewhat outdated. Sometimes they do just as well with our new treatments, but they definitely don't do as well with the old treatments. The other tests I always send are the beta 2 microglobulin, mainly because that goes into our scoring system for CLL, the CLL International Prognostic Index, but it's an adverse finding to have that elevated. And so I think that wraps up the bulk of all the prognostic tests that I send at time of meeting a new patient and trying to help understand what is our future going to be like.
Let me play that back for just a second and put it in terms that are not quite so technical. You have a toolbox now, and that toolbox has a lot of really nifty tools in it, where instead of saying you have leukemia, or you have chronic lymphocytic leukemia, or you have one of these genetic abnormalities, you're able to hone down to a very precise level of differentiation. That's where the term personal and precision care comes in, correct?
Excellent explanation. Yes.
Michele?
And I love this term and how that is happening more and more for CLL patients. Dr. Levy, before planning treatment, what do you like to understand from your patients so that you can learn more about them when it comes to prescribing their treatment?
Well, I mean, so obviously we're all different and everybody's cancer is also different. And the reason that we have jobs as oncologists is because hopefully, although I'm not sure that's true here, but hopefully we know more about CLL and the treatment options than the patients. And, you know, it's our job to explain to them all their various options and help them arrive with a choice that makes the most sense for them. So I think Dr. Coombs mentioned that, you know, we have a lot of options, but they haven't necessarily been compared head to head. So we can't tell you prospectively, you know, how treatment A compares to treatment B or treatment C. But there are certain guidelines of what's called preferred therapies and other alternative therapies that are also acceptable. And again, we need to speak with the patient and find out what is most important to them and explain everything about the treatment, including side effects, logistics, you know, expected outcomes if you choose one route versus another, cost, travel. There's a lot of things that go into everything. And, you know, again, this is our job to get them to ask the right questions and then answer those questions.
And what about comorbidities? Is it important for patients to discuss their other health issues with you, such as maybe cardiac issues or, you know, there's a myriad of so many other types?
No, absolutely, right. So this is what we were saying is we're all different and we all have different things that matter and we all have in a different place in our lives. So we take all of that into consideration. There's no question about it. I mean, the comorbidities are incredibly important, but we've certainly advanced past where we were 15 or 20 years ago when we were looking at whether patients are fit enough to take a therapy versus not. Because right now we're not necessarily looking at fitness for therapy as much as we're looking at what is the optimal therapy for them. You know, and many of the therapies that we have, actually, if you take a look at all of what's called the preferred category one recommendations from the NCCN panel, these were all studied in what we would have technically called a non-fit population before. So, you know, it's wonderful that we have all these highly effective therapies that we can give to people, even if their fitness is not optimal.
Dr. Coombs, how do doctors and patients make that call? How do you choose which drugs are up on deck first?
Well, you know, I think there are disease-related factors and then just patient-specific factors. And so tackling those one at a time, I think there is an important role for knowing what an individual's CLL risk findings are, because those can help inform how likely a treatment is to lead to a prolonged remission. So specific to a venetoclax-based approach in the frontline, what we do know is that there are shorter remissions in patients with the 17p deletion or TP53 mutation, and also shorter remissions for individuals with unmutated IGHV. I tend to be an optimist, and so my view is, gosh, these therapies, venetoclax-based, work way better than chemotherapy ever did for patients with these high-risk features. So we can still see lengthy remissions on the order of a little over 4 years for the 17P patients for progression-free survival, or around like 5-some years for the unmutated IGHV. But that is shorter than if you don't have those markers. So I do think it helps kind of weigh expectations on what to expect from a time-limited regimen if you have high-risk markers. If you have all favorable markers, venetoclax also works really well, and it just works longer than if you had negative markers. Now, the Bruton tyrosine kinase inhibitors as a class, those have really kind of leveled the playing field. And so if we divvy up patients with the unmutated and the mutated IGHV, in the chemo days, the unmutateds would relapse years faster than the mutated. There's not much of a difference. And so those drugs work really for everyone. Now, they're just so different, though, conceptually wise and side effect wise, which is why it is so important to kind of weigh the patient's comorbidities. So in addition to these disease related factors that could help, you know, gauge the relative success of any given therapeutic approach, there's patient specific factors. And so that's why it's so important for me to know not only the details of the CLL, but also the details of your specific other comorbidities, such as, do you have a high degree of cardiac comorbidities, where maybe, you know, we might be a little bit nervous about the BTK inhibitors, which can have cardiac side effects. I will say the newer drugs are much better than ibrutinib, but it is something I weigh. Whether you have significant kidney disease, which, you know, might be a little bit risky when we think of a drug like venetoclax that causes tumor lysis syndrome. Again, none of these are complete no-gos, but they help kind of tip the scale of which one are we favoring a bit more. And then, of course, I want to know what other medications you're taking, because a lot of medications can interact. And so that's something we have to make sure of. Often that's not a big deal. We just switch one out, but we have to know. And then lastly is kind of more social factors. You know, what are your preferences? Are you the type of person who kind of wants to do everything and doesn't mind a frequent schedule, but wants that payoff of then being done with treatment in a year, where we might lean more towards venetoclax obinutuzumab? Or are you someone who kind of wants to spend as little time at a doctor's office as possible and is okay with indefinite treatment, where we may lean more towards BTKI? So those are the three major categories I think of: disease factors, patient comorbidity, specific factors, and then, you know, social and preference.
This is so vital for patients. And this is something I ask a million questions, and I encourage patients to, so that they can become more empowered for their own care and self-advocate for themselves. And it's been so great hearing you and Dr. Levy both talk about things, about patients asking questions and you encouraging it, so that patients are not afraid of this.